found my niche. I have been working with post-acute providers now for well over 15 years, and I have never seen the group of healthcare providers that work so hard in terms of trying to do what's best for residents and to make sure that in their golden years, the end of their life, that they have a high quality of life and that they can be very comfortable and happy as they see the end of their life come, as their life come to an end. Today, I'm going to talk a little bit about some legal issues, some things that are hot in assisted living today on the legal front. I'm going to talk a little bit about human keys. I'm sure everybody knows Randy Kirkendall and his team, Dean Rito, Elaine McManus. They're working very hard to get those new regulations passed. They're going to be up this fall and probably go into effect in January. You have no idea how that's going to impact your operation, how you run your facility. It is huge. It's going to be overwhelming. I think I have some job security as a result of that. I'm not going to be going to Walmart and working as a greeter for a number of years. But we're trying to prepare you for some of that. And so when I get into the QMAP training, Kirky is going to talk a little bit about that too. How many of you employ a nurse, either an LPN or an RN, for your resident assessments to look at admissions? That is, you almost have to have a licensed nurse to assist you with those admissions today to make sure that the resident you think you're going to get is actually the resident you do get. Unfortunately, the availability of LPNs and RNs for assisted living is definitely starting to decline. We're seeing the issue in skilled nursing facilities. They can't even hire an RN. Have you had trouble keeping your nursing staff? No? That's good, actually. They may like to be a more independent nature. The fact that they can contract with you either for a set number of hours. But if you try to do some things that, let's look at the new regulations that are going to go into effect this coming, probably in January 2018, I think is when they're scheduled to go into effect. The role of your registered nurse and your LPN is definitely going to change. Working with those staff members now to prepare them for those changes. But we're having more and more violence in the workplace. And this is what is becoming a significant concern to me, because the residents that you would admit into your facilities are also changing. 5 years ago, how many of you were concerned about behaviors? Not that much.
Well,
okay, maybe, yeah. But are behaviors a priority and an issue today? Yes. Behaviors, the propensity for violence, but we also have the risk of violence not only with resident to resident, but we also have the risk of staff and the staff that you're recruiting to fill some of your positions. But the violence in the workplace, OSHA, has definitely gotten wind of this, in that what percent of the workplace violence do you think hits healthcare workers? Of all the workplace assaults, what's the percentage that you would guess affect healthcare workers?
50%.
And that's the behavioral component that I was just mentioning that we have to talk about. But OSHA decided in June of 2015, have any of you undergone an OSHA inspection? You prepare, that may be in the future in addition to the health department survey. But they're starting, this is the actual front page of their guidelines for preventing workplace violence. Let's say you have a resident and you know that they have their care plan, you've assessed them, and they have some behaviors that involve aggressiveness, combativeness, striking out. And your main concern is usually what? You don't want them to hit another resident. OSHA throws out to you the other of your staff. OSHA can come in and cite sometimes violations against an employer for not ensuring a safe environment for their workers. This is also part of the workplace violence response policy that OSHA is looking for you to identify. Well, what are the behaviors that actually trigger the workplace violence? If you look at it, the root cause investigation, you should all be doing root cause investigations of any type of an incident that involves abuse, neglect, resident to resident, staff to resident, any type of a behavior. That's under your quality management plan that you had to submit to the health department back in the end of 2015. That's a licensing standard that you have to have in place. It's under Rule 3.1. So, root cause analysis and the evaluation for every one of those incidents. Don't stop an investigation at worker error or unpredictable event. I can't tell you how many of those occurrence reports I've seen, and they start to look at what was the root cause analysis. The worker didn't know what to do. It was the worker's fault, didn't anticipate, didn't keep a close eye on the resident. OSHA will not accept that anymore. You have to actually dig into, well, why didn't the worker actually look at that incident? Is it a factor of training? And that's an aspect that is so new to all of you, and it's very concerning to me that you're going to get caught in this. And that is, well, we've never had to do that before. Why are we having to do this now? But OSHA, to the point of their cracking down on healthcare employers, Brookdale University Hospital and Medical Center, granted these are much bigger facilities than the ones that you operate and run. In August of 2014, OSHA fined $78,000 for inadequate violence prevention program. They had 40 incidents in 2 months. Now that kind of frequency, you guys aren't seeing, but guess what? These patients that are coming out of the hospitals, where are they going? They're not necessarily going to home. They may be going to a skilled nursing facility, especially rehab, let's say some rehab that might be involved. But then cognitively, they don't need to stay in a SNF. They're coming down to your level. So 40 incidents in 2 months, another facility, they got cited almost $13,000 for failing to keep the workplace free of hazards. That's usually one of the criteria that impacts assisted living facilities. 8 incidents in 3.5 months. I can tell you that the incidence rate for abuse in skilled nursing facilities is annually at least 7 incidents a year. And this is Colorado statistics. So you guys are going to have probably even a higher rate. In other words, on average, every facility will have at least 7 instances of abuse every year. The neglect in Colorado is the area that I think is underreported because everybody doesn't really understand. Ooh, perhaps do this. This omission, this failure, really equates to neglect and should have been reported. But this is big stuff for assisted living, even though you kind of are looking at that, oh, this only really happened to us. I can tell you 2018, the Corky and the association invites me back. I'm going to have new information about how assisted living are getting directly involved in this. So the sources for violence. You know, the caregiver or resident to resident, we see that probably more so than any other time. The area of caregiver and resident, I was involved in 2 situations involving AIDS, sexually abusing residents. This was about 3 years ago. And it was horrific. Both of those AIDS are now in prison. One is serving a 26-year term. But it was horrible. Do you know how they got caught? They both were voted employees of the month. A family used a clock because they're permanently persistent vegetative state daughter. We had a stroke. She was 32. She was in her bed, basically couldn't communicate or anything, but total care. But the parents were so devastated by the injury because of the stroke, and thinking our daughter is going to be one of those that wakes up. So they put covertly, inside, you know, never disclosing to the facility, put a camera into the room that was in this clock radio that was playing, because they were convinced the music would stimulate her to wake up. And was this that far-fetched? Not really. And they wanted to see her reaction to the video, to the music. And instead of capturing her joy, her smiles, her excitement, they captured the male. They sexually violated her. How's that for 180? And but for that video, they would have never found, probably eventually, but certainly wouldn't have found and identified the situation as early as they did. It happens. It's out there. You can't ignore them. Resident on caregiver, that's where we see some of the workplace violence. I had this involved the skilled nursing facility, and I was kind of upset because Randy Kirkendall and his team thought it was okay for the resident to sexually assault the staff in the facility because there was no actual injury. The staff should have been trained in order to be able to handle that kind of incident. The staff were so indoctrinated, trained to culture change, that whatever the resident does is okay as long as it doesn't injure another resident. And they didn't think about the staff. And so we had a very hard time involuntarily discharging that resident. But this is pretty much the areas of risk that you have. Let's talk about some of the facilities, the assisted living facility, and some of the incidents that you may have. Ooh, that wasn't supposed to be in there. Well, here, NBC News, on January 5th, 2017, just about 6 months ago, an 87-year-old woman's death after an assisted living resident pushed her was ruled a homicide. That last word is key. The district attorney had decided to charge that female resident with pushing the other woman because of the death. Now, you may think, well, most of our residents have some form of dementia. Some of these residents can actually be criminally charged with the consequences of their actions. But they got into an argument. One female fell on, causing her to fall to the ground. She fractured her hip. How many of you know that a fractured femur, 50% of the time, after that little injury occurs, the risk of death within the next year is 50%. Very, very high. You don't want to break a month later, the resident died with complications of the fracture. And here the aggressor, even though he had dementia, psychosis, and cognitive impairment, the DA still decided, you guys may not think we're going to file charges, but we have enough evidence here to validate, prove intent of one resident to push the other. Here's another one. This happened in Chicago, Illinois. An 80-year-old male resident who happened to be a preacher died after being shot by another male resident who was also a preacher. One was a wheelchair-bound resident, but they frequently argued about religion. Now, what's the key factor here that you should be concerned about?
Gun.
Why and how did one resident, because in assisted living, you have really no idea some of the personal belongings that your residents have. Mm-hmm. But one, they got into an argument. They were known to argue about religion, but one just called off and shot the other one. This one is kind of the same thing with two males who were known to get into an argument about the television. That's a pretty common area. In the common areas, you know, what program are we going to watch? It's too loud. I want to watch this. They got into an argument over the TV, one push on the other, who again fractured it and later died. And then the district attorney and the facility basically said, we're not going to go ahead and file charges. The facility was promoting the idea that this was dementia, cognitive impairment. Male resident who was the perpetrator, but that male resident was moved to another facility.
Do you want questions at the end or ongoing?
Oh, I think you're fine. Are you guys okay? I know we're
No, absolutely. That's
okay.
Fine.
Yeah. So the first case study, it was ruled a homicide. Third case study, it was not.
Right.
And wouldn't there have been, I mean, a precedent set? Because I believe the first case study was prior to the one that was in Washington State, the
Good
third.
Question. And a lot of this gets into law.
I don't want to get into the weeds. Yes.
But Law and Order, I think, is one of the TV shows that deals with criminal law. Every state has their own criteria and their own statutory criminal code.
Okay.
And one state, the DA, you know, DA's district attorney positions are very political. They're elected positions, and they decide what case am I going to take. And whenever we have a resident, an elderly person, at-risk, vulnerable adult dying as a result of another resident pushing them, that is newsworthy. Mm-hmm. It's, as the DA would say, it's a sexy case. Mm-hmm. It generates a lot of public. Do I need to prosecute this case? Is the degree of dementia, cognitive impairment, always the same for residents?
No.
It varies quite a bit. One day they can be extremely lucid, very clear, thinking, speech, everything you look at and kind of go, wow, how did this happen? And then the next day, total confusion, garbled speech, and that degree of variability. It will come down to the state, the DA, and the degree of the dementia, and what the DA thinks he or she can prove, and if they decide to take the case or not. We had one here in Colorado, and the district attorney said absolutely no way. But the criminal investigator for the Medicaid Fraud Control Unit was adamant about charging a female resident with the same thing, pushing another resident, who died, fell, suffered a hematoma, and was dead within 30 days.
Thank you.
So, yes, regarding the other one.
In Colorado, what is the gun law regarding possession of a gun?
I'll be there to check. Our office recently did a multi-state review of whether facilities could prevent guns in the facility. I believe Colorado is one of those where we can. Give me your name, and then let me email, or I'll send it to court, and then you can send it to people.
Because I have a I take care of him for this thing.
See, and
and I had a gentleman that had a gun, and I had to allow him to keep the gun. He did keep it out of his car locked, and he kept the bullets in the house. But I could not take the gun.
Oh,
he had the right to possess a firearm in the state of Colorado.
He does. And he may have a permit authorizing that.
Yes.
But where did he keep the gun? See the distinction?
Yeah. In his car.
That's personal property. Do you have any control over your residence vehicles?
No.
I believe though for him he couldn't keep the gun in the facility. That's where I'm gonna check on that and then make sure I follow up with you.
Very good one.
Very good one. Very good one.
Is he gonna
Oh yeah, because it's concealed weapon permits in Colorado. It's really kind of a changing arena for that. It's just that you control your facility, that's your community, that's where you control. But what they do when they go outside the facility, and in particular if they have, some of them may have another apartment, some of them may have personal belongings and family members' homes, but the vehicle, so you can keep it there, probably lock the door. only difficulty you have is what? Not knowing whether he, you know, gets the gun, brings it into the facility, and then we have that kind of evidence.
Is there any clause that, like, it's your facility and also, like, your parking area belonging to, like, the facility? I'm just asking. So, what's it?
It's his car.
It's his car, yeah, but.
Yes, it may be in your parking lot.
Yeah.
But again, the property, the confines of the automobile markets, you have, you can tell me, yeah, you can keep it on the deal on the lawn. But these are not going to be easy issues for you to solve. There's going to be extenuating circumstances in a lot of them. So here's the priority for OSHA training. On your staff, deal with workplace violence, and I consider workplace violence to include resident-to-resident altercation. So you have to look at that. Basically, committed to employees participating in the safety issues, programs that you have in place. Identifying those hazards. Here, you've already done that with the gun in the car. You know that, okay, it's a potential hazard. Is this resident mentally functioning that he can control the gun in the car? Hazard prevention and control, safety training, record keeping, program evaluation. All of that goes with your quality management plan. How many of you know what I'm talking about when I say quality management plan? Okay, caregiver on resident interactions. How many of you endorse that culture change philosophy? Be sure that residents get to choose their, have, speak their preferences for mealtime foods, et cetera. It gets to be always a balance you have. Yeah, we can allow you to go ahead and state your preferences, do what you want to do, but there are limits. The limit is always the same. If their actions in any way cross that line and jeopardize another's safety, then that's where culture change kind of takes the secondary step and safety takes the priority. The example that I can think of is a van driver taking a resident who was in a wheelchair on one of the wings, and the resident saying, oh, I've got some stomach problems today, I don't want my seatbelt done. Van driver says, okay, but I need to fasten the wheelchair down to the floor of the van. And does. What happens? Van driver gets in the van, starts to go forward, hits a red light, breaks. What happens to the resident? Slides right out of that chair, lands on the knees, and distal fractures on both knees. And distal fractures are automatically related to trauma. So, the resident didn't want the seatbelt done. All the van driver knew was, we're supposed to let residents decide what they want to do. All this being alert, though, from those criminal background checks, robust screening for your new hires, and then staying alert. I'm sorry. How many of you have ever witnessed elder bullying? It's amazing. Can you share what you experienced?
Me? Just the mean talk amongst the residents. Sometimes somebody will just say something like, she's so terrible, and kind of getting other people to kind of rally around.
It's almost like a peer pressure, mm-hmm. What you sometimes see with kids, smaller kids, but we're starting to see this with the elderly too. There was actually a study done at Arizona State University. Their study results show 10 to 20% of the elders experiencing some of the bullying. It might be the verbal, could be antisocial. Oh, we won't invite her to go on this because she can't hear. She's rude. She's, she swears a lot. We don't want her with us.
men and women both equally participate in bullying, but the men primarily are noted for physical bullying, and the women not so much. But the common hallmark is always the dementia, mental health disorders, and that cognitive impairment. Acting on public safety concerns, how many of you have ever had a staff member that you were very concerned about an incident that they potentially abused or neglected a resident and you didn't want them to go and work someplace else? You've never had a, I've talked to a lot of employers and they're concerned because I don't want that person to come back to me or somebody like that. And I want to prevent them from going to another facility. We actually have a statute in Colorado that gives you the option. You don't have the duty to tell a prospective employer when they call and they want a reference that this is what happened with that employee. But if it involves abuse, drug diversion, like for your QMAPs, any violation of drug or alcohol policies, or a crime or violence like abuse, you can tell a prospective employer that you have a very strong suspicion or confirmation after an investigation that that employee abused a resident and not have any repercussions for defamation, preventing that individual from obtaining a new job. In other words, you can't be accused of blacklisting them. Now, I'm not endorsing this 100% of the time for every single employee. If you get a former employee is out there recruiting for a new job and you get the prospective employer contacting you. But if you have those cases where it's so egregious and you want to make sure that they don't go on to somebody else, here's the statute that actually can help with it. Here I gave you everything on there. Dangers from the outside. Have any of you encountered what I would call potentially violent, abusive family members coming into the facility? This is one that I've seen quite a few and actually helped the facility get a temporary restraining order to make sure the family member couldn't come in. The resident, we made arrangements for the resident to leave the facility to be able to visit with the abusive, violent family member, and so be it. But you have to look at restraining orders. Your employees may have one. Anybody have the experience of an employee coming to them and saying, I'm getting a divorce, and I've got this restraining order against my spouse, and I want some protection? You actually then, as soon as that order comes to you as an employer, you have the responsibility to put in security measures so that that spouse doesn't have access to that employee while the bride's in at work. That's really, really big today because we're seeing more and more of the restraining orders. How many of you have security cameras on the outside of your facilities? Yeah. That's actually good. It helps with controlling access into the building, but there's no one-size-fits-all. It's kind of got to be customized for your particular facility to make sure that you're getting the information that you have and that you want to get out of it. So, QMAT training. Corby, do you want to talk about this since you are getting involved in that kind of the public training? Let me just tell you that QMAT training is a big issue with the health department. They have now allowed individuals, the public, private vendors to do the QMAT training instead of having to go to the official training programs.
Well, as you know, we went ahead, I think Randy might talk about this at the spring conference, but we introduced legislation and we privatized QMAT, so it's not going through the CDP and G. All they're doing is recording that you've taken the program and that you are taking it. But now entities can go ahead and be certified by the department. And the first ones will be coming online July 1. We're in the process, Cal is in the process of becoming certified. And then we will have a cadre of QMAP trainers throughout the state so that we can address any of our members' needs anywhere in the state so that they can get their people trained. But it's, you're going to have lots of choices for this now because there will be other associations that will do it, as well as the individuals that are already qualified to be, that are QMAPs, will be doing their own business. They'll be getting themselves certified too. So you're going to have a shakeout time, probably 6 months to a year, to see what happens with all this. The nice thing is about this is now that it's out there in the open, there's going to be some competition, which means the program will probably be enhanced. It won't just be what's in the rules and regs in the statute, but there'll be some other things that aren't covered by rules and regs and statute, like legal responsibilities, talking about those particular things. So that you're going to see, you're going to start to see programs that are going to have a greater number of issues covered in there. But you also need to see the quality of those programs go up. So anyway, it's just now beginning. July 1 is when the first ones can go ahead and certify. And everybody who wants to train has to go through the process and be registered with CDPHR. So we're excited about it because we get to do this for the benefit of the members, and we can be totally all over the state and be able to help service the needs. So we're excited about it. So that's what's going on from our perspective.
Well, the training requirements were being debated within the health department. Some of your members called us and wanted to know about what could be trained, included in the training program for drugs to be administered, and what shouldn't be administered. And I know Tom will be interested in this. I can tell you that the nebulizers and inhalers and suppositories were, from a nursing perspective, of concerns to me, in that there are some factors that should be taken into consideration when that type of medication is being administered. And it turns out that nebulizer treatments, I don't believe, are in the curriculum. Inhalers, maybe. However, the health department agreed that you can decide for your own facility what you're going to allow and what you're going to exclude. But you have to tell the residents on admission what's excluded. And it has to be expressly stated. Every single treatment type of medication that you're not administering has to be listed actually on that resident admission agreement. So this is really important, sir.
Can we put that in our agreement that they must be self-administered, if at all?
And what if they can't self-administer?
Then they can't be there.
Or
they have somebody else do it.
What if the nurse of the community teaches them how to do nebulizer?
I wouldn't do it. Just because the nebulizer treatments, there are too many things that can go wrong with it. But right now, I don't know. I talked with two folks, and they said it's not in the health department approved curriculum for QMAP training. If it's not in the curriculum, then it's prohibited flat out. And if you're having your staff, your QMAPs do nebulizer treatments, I would highly encourage you to reevaluate that and decide whether or not it's something they want to continue to do. If self-administration, they can't do it, and they aren't able to self-administer, there's no family member, you have one other alternative.
Home care.
Home care. You can always take a contract with somebody from home care to come in and to do the treatment. Did you have another question?
So it's on the same lines as this.
Yes. Now, the nebulizer treatment is because you're using a device, machine for the administration, and too many things can go wrong with that, and it's over time. It's not just putting the pill in the mouth or giving the resident a pill to take in the mouth. But the insulin is definitely prohibited, and any nurses in the room I don't know how you feel about digital lectures, but unless you pass, it's not in the curriculum. So right there, it's prohibited, and you need to make other arrangements for it. The one thing that I thought was kind of interesting, that insulin G2 medications, if HIPAA, Department of Human Services permits, we now have legislation that allows unlicensed individuals, aides, to go ahead and do G2 feedings. I don't know if you knew about that at all, Mount Marina. So you're kind of frowning. I wasn't supportive of the legislation. And then if you have somebody who has some type of an allergy and you have an EpiPen, and 911 directs your QMAP to be able to do it and give it, there's a provision that the urgent first aid for a life-saving measure, that there may be an exception for it. So routes that are clearly within QMAP training, the oral, the topical, the drops. I put inhalers in there because I haven't seen the QMAP training that actually allows for inhalers.
It always has talked to inhalers.
So if it's in there and you decide you want to do it, you're okay. But if you decide you don't want to do the inhalers along with the nebulizers, it just has to be in your resident admission agreement. The new Chapter 24 regulations, they did a revision on that that has a very heavy focus on QMAP documentation for medication administration. I have not yet seen a clean set of MARs when the QMAPs do the documentation. If there's any type of training that you really focus on, it's that documentation to make sure that the QMAPs are following it. You should be doing almost a weekly audit of every single one of your QMAPs to make sure that they're appropriately administering the medications and following all of the different requirements. Cybersecurity. I just heard Conan O'Brien tell a joke the other day, and I had to stop and pause. Girl Scouts now can get a badge in cybersecurity. That kind of shows you where we've gone. And Conan's joke was, so make sure you're looking at all your credit card for those orders for thin mints. Cybersecurity is big. And especially for, how many of you are using EMR for all your documentation? That is a big issue right there. How many of your staff use a cell phone? For work-related purposes that you actually give them? Is a cell phone being used for any communication between them while on the unit, while at work? Do you have a policy that prohibits cell phone use while at work? Some of you do, some of you don't. This is so big today. Let me just kind of show you a couple of examples. These are healthcare providers. On a fairly big scale, but to show you how the Federal Department of Health and Human Services with the Office of Civil Rights are starting to look at HIPAA violations because an employee took their laptop on the way home, stopped at King Super's, left the laptop in the front seat, didn't lock the car, came back, laptop is gone. And on this one facility, Metro Community Provider Network, which was a federally qualified health center, they had a 2011 breach for electronic PHI, 3,200 patients. Every time I hear this, I start to think of wherever my cell phone is, because I'm out on the road quite a bit, same with my laptop. You cannot physically leave those two items anywhere unless they're fully within your control. Phishing schemes are allowing access to employee email accounts. We're going to talk, I'll give you a couple of examples with that. Here's a baiting example. I don't think you can grievance hall. You get an email, complimentary stay at Marriott Hotel. We've all heard about this. Wow. Gift card value, $500. The date it's effective, when it expires. Please claim your Marriott gift card for 3 complimentary nights at any destination. Life is good again, right? And if it's too good to be true,
it is.
And so 1 gift card per person, please use. And then as soon as you see your gift card is ready, please go here. I now with, I'm with a pretty big company, but we actually have, anytime an email comes up that we think is phishing, we send it over there and those guys take care of it. It is so common and prevalent now. Let's talk about some others. Here's another one. Tax forms have been rejected. Here's what went wrong. None of us like the IRS and having to file taxes. My husband does elder law, and he recently, within the last year, has gotten a lot of calls from clients. I just got a phone call from the IRS, and my gosh, if I don't make this payment, I'm going to be in arrears, and they're going to get me for tax fraud, for non-payment. My husband said, IRS doesn't call wrong people. I just got one.
So did I. I took a screenshot of it on my phone because I get them on my phone to my landline.
I knew right away they did not call.
Yep.
They write.
Yes. So, your poor residents, sometimes they may get this and then they're thinking, my kids are supposed to be paying all my taxes and they aren't. Is this something that I need to get involved with? Here's another one. Any openings? Hello there. I saw your website and I'm very interested in working for your company. And you're kind of going, we've been trying to fill that QMAP position for months. Please see my attached CV. Your help is greatly appreciated. You go into that attachment and there they are. Here's another one. Thank you for, this is the one that I really like. Thank you for purchasing your yearly plan for Log Bean in Pro and 25 computers. We had a client that just went with a brand new computer system, got everybody new computers, and one guy was having trouble with it, and just went within 24 hours of getting his computer, and got a message similar to this saying, we're here to help you get your new computer set up, and all you need to do is log in here, and we'll be fine. He did that, and it was a huge healthcare provider and access to every single patient's records. All the PHI shows up just like that within that period of time. But regarding this order, I don't think that's related to this. But anyway, you can see how easy it is.
That's on her laptop. You just have
to pay attention. Yeah, that's on my laptop.
Cyber.
It won't let me. There it is. So, anyway, here's one that you have to be very, very careful of that stuff. And look at, they even have a credit card number and it might be the same as yours. Those last 4 digits of your credit card are out there. And it's for sale in so many ways that you can't even begin to imagine.
I don't know if you're going to talk about this one. I got ransom.
Oh, yes.
And that cost me $250 to get my files.
Oh, really?
And he said it was from Microsoft and all this other stuff. Yeah, I couldn't. It was bad.
That happened to Fred Knox in my office.
Right, those too.
But he took action and contacted the police, and they took it from there. So, ransoming is when somebody says, I've gotten into your files, and thank you very much, but now if you want those files back, you have to pay the ransom. And it's extremely disconcerting, and you're thinking, how much trouble am I in? How did they get the files? But we're talking, these hackers contacting you and claiming a ransom. ended up unlucky, but.
I did, I did. It's $250 smarter and poorer, but the funny thing was, there was a big, we all had to do warehouse and do this transfer from one bowl of people to do this, that. Why don't you think about buying this stuff too, and working this, and all this stuff on that, so just be careful.
Very good, I'm glad you shared the story. And it's, doesn't have anything to do with your intelligence.
No.
Your availability, I mean, it's just this stuff that's out there today. So, slow down, do your research. Delete requests for financial information, passwords or identifiers. Reject offers for help. Nobody wants to help anybody. And for sure not for free. So, you have to screen, you always have to be on guard. This is particularly hard for me. I grew up in Minnesota and I have a hard time believing anybody could lie to me. I've gotten smarter over the years. But this kind of stuff, for the elderly, it's not only for you as employers, but for your residents, especially if they're computer savvy. And they may not be that savvy, but they see something like this and then they get kind of startled as a result of it. How many of you go to Starbucks? You've been to Starbucks. And have you ever looked through your iPhone or a laptop when you were at Starbucks? There are a lot of people though that were on their laptop doing work at Starbucks today. You don't realize how devices like this little crazy weird pineapple can be sitting innocently next to the table that you're working on. And some guy has it maybe covertly covered up, but it's still out there. These devices can pick up your signal and everything that you're doing. And all of a sudden you think, hey, I'm protected. I'm very public sending, my gosh, Starbucks, they're taking my $5. Wouldn't they have some security measures in place for their free Wi-Fi? No. These devices are, I shouldn't get into politics, I won't do that. But we're pineapples. And the devices, you can't even begin to imagine how easy it is. Have you ever gone to a hotel and you're trying to get in on the internet and you see all of the different devices, internet sites that you can latch onto? Even in my neighborhood, I can tell you all the neighbors around and what their websites are, or their servers are, and my access to use their internet. There's nothing, there are no boundaries or lines for all of this cyberspace anymore. So the weird pineapples are long gone. There's some other device that's much smaller now that's out there, and it's just waiting for you and your laptop or your cell phone to come on in so that it can have at it. So I don't mean this to be doom and gloom, but brain, it is entitled brain food. And I guess it's food for thought when you're dealing with your business practices and some of the things that are happening today that you may not even be aware of. Anyway, thank you for the invitation to visit with you this afternoon. And until the next time, I hope I don't see you in the future. Do we have any questions?
Yes. Yeah. Back to the letting a future employer know about the employee that does those things. But you still cannot ask them to have a background in a reference check. Is that correct? You can't ask.
Like, sure. Yeah, so let's say you want to know you've got this employee that looks like a dream come true into your agency, right, your facility. And you call their references, you can ask for the information. Whether or not the employer wants to give it to you is something else.
Because I find it's meaning, it used to be you could say like, is this employer, would they be eligible for rehire?
Yes.
That was still the thing. Mm-hmm. And now I've had employers say, I won't answer that question.
Yes.
I will only answer their days of employment.
Yes.
Well, that does you no good.
It does not do you any good. But I'm saying for this situation, you have an employee who did a really, really bad bad influence residents. And no remorse, no acceptance of accountability. And you want to make sure that they don't go out and harm another resident. You get a call 2 weeks later. I'm calling about Chuck Smith. I understand he worked for you. Yes, he did. What position was he in? He was a QMAP, an aide or something, personal care provider, a caregiver. Were there any incidents that involved some conduct that you were concerned about? You can say yes. And the employer pushes, and you can say, we believe after an investigation of an incident that he abused a resident. Now, the former employee is going to get wind of this probably from the prospective employer saying, I can't hire you because you were involved in an incident of abuse at such and such facility. That former employee goes, oh my gosh, they defamed me, they're preventing me from earning my livelihood, I'm going to sue them. Can still sue you, but you have a defense under that statute to be able to say, an abuse incident, drug aversion, crimes of violence, those are the exceptions that you can't come after me for. You still have the legal situation to deal with, but ethically, morally, professionally, you've prevented that individual from continuing to perpetrate their abuse and their harms on other individuals. But I would say that the majority of providers today are still dates of employment, position held, and it may or may not be eligible for rehire. But I also know several clients have told me, well, Carolyn, you know, there's a very covert line out there of communication. And I have no problems with that at all. That, I mean, none of us want to get those kinds of employees, but we also don't want them to go anywhere else. So, any other questions that anybody might have? Good questions today. The brain food must have been good. Yeah.
Are your slides going to be available somewhere?
Sure.
And this is all on film, you can go online and get it too. Okay, so whichever which way you'd like it delivered.
Okay.
Well, Carol, thank you. Let's give her a nice round of applause.